And finally tonight, some politics of the past and a new book on the presidency of Lyndon Johnson. Judy Woodruff has our conversation.
He was large in stature, personality, and political ambition. The consummate legislator, a vice president who was thrust into the presidency. Lyndon Baines Johnson was complex, outsized, contradictory, and ultimately fascinating. His was a presidency of civil rights, health reform, a war on poverty, but mostly defined by the war in Vietnam. Now comes a new book on his term in office, Lyndon B. Johnson. It's part of the Times book series on the American presidency. The author is Charles Peters, the founder and former editor of the Washington Monthly magazine. He's also worked in politics and government. He ran John F. Kennedy's West Virginia campaign, and he helped to launch the Peace Corps. Charlie Peters, it's so good to have you with us.
It's great to be with you, Judy.
One thing that comes across here is this outsized personality and his ability to get what he needed, what he wanted politically. He persuasive, cajoled, intimidated people. Where did that phenomenal political ability come from?
Well, his father was a politician. His father was a populist politician who anticipated Johnson in being, he fought the Klan back when the Ku Klux Klan was very, very powerful in Texas. So his father had political courage, and his father was just a natural politician who was elected to the, he served 8 years in the Texas legislature.
And you write that Johnson was able to accomplish incredible things.
Only FDR rivals his legislative accomplishment, and so that ranks him with the greatest president.
Civil rights,
civil
and
rights,
Medicare.
The Voting Rights Act of 1965 has changed this country. Obama would not be president without the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Medicare changed the life of seniors in this country. The combination of Social Security and Medicare made so much difference for the old age of Americans.
You also write, Charlie Peters, about his weaknesses, the string of extramarital affairs, the abusive behavior you write about toward his subordinates.
I will say a touching thing about the affairs is that the women involved, all of them retained great fondness for Johnson. And of course, his wife Lady Bird seemed, as far as anybody can see, truly adored him. So that was the good side. The bad side was, he, except for one of these affairs, he would boast about the relationships to other people, which to me was just a horrible thing to do. He was he would make aides go into the bathroom with him when he that didn't seem very charming to me. And he could say cruel things to people and not just in front of other people. Be abusive. I was troubled by this so much, I called up his old friend, Liz Carpenter, and I said, Liz, this is finally the thing that I just can't answer. And she said, he's just that way. You have to accept him, warts and all.
And there was this persistent rivalry with the Kennedys. Was that his doing or theirs?
Both sides were at fault. I think both, particularly Lyndon and Bobby, saw the worst side of each other, and they were perfectly right about the worst side of each other. Johnson saw Bobby as the guy who tried to get Castro assassinated. He saw the unpleasant side of Bobby's personality, and so Johnson understood all the bad. He never understood the things that by the end of Bobby's life made him a great man. Similarly, Bobby understood all the deal-making, vulgar side of Lyndon Johnson, and he didn't have any understanding or sympathy with the great side and the great things the man was capable of doing. And the worst thing the Kennedys did, though, to Johnson was they hid Bobby's visit to Debrinen, the dovish gesture that had ended at the Cuban Missile Crisis. So Johnson thought, and the American public thought, that the lesson of the Cuban Missile Crisis was we were eyeball to eyeball and we made the other guy blink, when the truth was both sides blinked.
You say he belongs probably in what you say is the second tier
yeah.
of great presidents, and that was not something that was recognized when he was alive.
No, I think he belongs with Jackson, Teddy Roosevelt, Jefferson, right below the top Washington,
despite
Lincoln,
Vietnam.
Roosevelt. Yeah. Yes, but Vietnam, it's hard to say despite Vietnam, you know. Someone used that line with John Kenneth Galbraith, and he says, that's like saying Switzerland would be flat without the Alps.
Vietnam was what?
Vietnam was his presidency, and it was he was wrong. He was just wrong. He was a man who worried terribly about his manhood, about being courageous. One of his aides told me that the aide was leaving, and he wanted a nice letter, warm letter from Johnson when he left the White House. And he asked Johnson's secretary, how am I going to get the nice letter? And she said, when you send in your resignation letter, praise his courage. The guy sent in the letter, and he got a very warm letter in response. So.
Finally, Charlie Peters, any lessons from Lyndon Johnson for this current president, President Obama, and the enormous challenges he's facing?
Well, I think at Afghanistan, you have to look at Vietnam and say there were many, many arguments for being in Vietnam, for staying in Vietnam, that the anti-war movement, for instance, didn't want to face and has never wanted to face in the history of the war. Just as there are many, many good arguments for being in Afghanistan today, very compelling arguments. But the point I hope Obama pays attention to was what destroyed the chance of success in Vietnam was a corrupt government that was did not have the faith of the people all down the line from the lowest level to the top. I'm afraid we're going to face a similar situation in Afghanistan. The other thing I would urge Obama to pay attention to in Johnson's history was, and this was true of Jack Kennedy and many other Democratic presidents, but it's what got Johnson in trouble in Vietnam, it's fear of Republican criticism. When the Tonkin Gulf episode happened, Johnson, his first instinct was just to dismiss it as a South Vietnamese provocation,
right.
So he wasn't going to make anything out of it. But then an influential advisor said to him, well, Barry Goldwater, who was running against him that year, Barry Goldwater is going to say, you lack courage, you lack guts, you've got to appear tough. So then Johnson made a big thing out of the Tonkin Gulf, went to the Congress, got the Tonkin Gulf resolution, and we were off on the wrong road.
Too worried about the other
Too worried about what the other party would say.
The book is Lyndon B. Johnson. Charles Peters is the author. Thank you very much for talking with us about it.
I've enjoyed it, Judy. Thank you.